I'd like to take this opportunity to welcome everyone to this memorial service for Sharon Williams. I know the family appreciates everybody being here this afternoon, and I think it would be appropriate and fitting if we open this memorial service with prayer. Heavenly Father God, as we gather here this afternoon to honor the life of Sharon Williams, I would ask that you comfort these family members and friends as only you can do. I ask that your love and your peace fill the void that's in every heart today. And God, I ask that you place a special bond of love upon each one of these family members, that they can lean on each other today, tomorrow, and in weeks and months to come. And I ask that you would just give me words of comfort this afternoon for these family members and friends gathered here this afternoon. In the name of your Son, Jesus, we pray. Amen. Sharon Lee Doughty Raley Williams was born on April the 24th, 1946, on a farm near Anadarko to Jess Ray Doughty and Ruth Morris Doughty. Sharon passed away on July the 15th, 2020, in Corpus Christi, Texas, at the age of 74. Her siblings were Loretta, Norma Sue, Will Ray, Sonny, Sally, and Larry. As a child, Sharon loved riding horses, but she contracted hepatitis at a young age, but remains resilient through it all. She married Gene Raley on January 7th, 1963, and two children were born to this marriage. John Arthur was born prematurely and did not survive. Deborah Gale was her second born. Sharon worked at this real nursing home, but somehow missed her calling to be a nurse. She enjoyed camping and fishing and cruising. You could always find Sharon at the bedside of any family member that was ill. On September the 24th, 1988, Sharon married Roland Williams, and they had a very happy life together. Sharon also loved to work in her garden. She loved her family and made sure that they knew each one was loved. She was very proud of her children and grandchildren. Sharon's survivors today include a daughter, Debbie Cronemeyer, and her husband, Tim, of Corpus Christi, Texas, a sister, Loretta Martin, of Seaman, Oklahoma, a sister, Sally Gibson, and her husband, Craig, of Sorrel, Oklahoma, a sister-in-law, Linda Dowdy, of Sorrel, Oklahoma, a granddaughter, Carissa Scarborough, and her husband, Luke, of Arnold, Missouri, and many bonus grandchildren and nephews and nieces whom she loved as her own. Again, I'd like to take this opportunity to welcome everybody to this service honoring Sharon. And I thank you guys for allowing us to have a part in this service. We do consider it an honor. Some of you guys may not realize that Dowdy and the Ackley family go back a long ways. I grew up in the same area that Sharon grew up, on the south part of Sorrel. The only thing that separated us was a railroad track. And growing up, we always argued which was the good side of the railroad track to live on. But as I look back, I don't think any of the places down there was a real good spot. But we did have a lot of fun down there on that side of town. And of course, Sally and Larry were both my age, and then we went to school together for 12 years. So very familiar with the Dowdy family, and just appreciate you guys including us today as we celebrate the life of Sharon Williams. And it was a life worth celebrating. Sharon was someone that enjoyed life. And that's what we're going to do this afternoon, is celebrate her life. Yes, your heart's hurt. And yes, there's a tremendous loss. But through it all, I believe Sharon would want you to remember the good things. I believe she would want you to smile and remember those things that you did together. So for a few minutes, let's just look back at a life well lived over 70 years. She faced some major health issues as a young child, but she was a fighter and she fought through those things. She didn't let those things hold her back. Over the past few years, as Sharon was able to attend church with us at Sorrel, it didn't matter whether she was on oxygen. She always had something uplifting and good to say to me after church. That's not always the case for a lot of people after a sermon. But no matter what I said, no matter what we did, Sharon always had something uplifting and always wanted to talk to me, and I will always appreciate that. But, you know, as I speak at a lot of funerals for men and women both from small towns like Sorrel, I find that a lot of them have things very much in common. And I think Sharon would be one in that same group. And I mean no disrespect is what I'm fixing to say here at all. But growing up in a small town, in a rural atmosphere like Sharon did, her goals in life were very simple. She didn't care a lot for high society. She really didn't care about getting her name in the Sorrel weekly news every week. Sharon was not someone that had to have the best of everything. Her goals, she just wanted to be a good wife. She wanted to be a good mother. She wanted to be a good sister. She wanted to be a good aunt. And she wanted to be a good friend. And for those of you that knew her the best, I think all of you would agree that Sharon was a success at those things. And those things are what will really matter in life. It's not how much money we make. It's not our position in life. It's how we interact and how we love those that God has put in our trust. And I think all of you can look back and smile at Sharon and the things that she did for you. She liked to work in her garden and liked to fish, but I think the number one thing that she did, she liked to travel. And I understand that she especially liked cruises. No matter where the boat was going, she would get on it and go under one circumstance. And I really don't know how to put this except just lay it out. And that boat had to be stocked with a lot of adult beverages. If that was the case, she would go anywhere. I can see her grinning right now with that statement. And I guess you might say, from what I've heard, talked to some of the people, that Sharon might be a little on the ornery side, maybe a little bit on the mischievous side. But I guess the main thing that all of you know, and this was stressed by everyone that I talked to, is how much she really loved each one of you. And she took a special interest in all of you. And you never left her presence without her telling you that she loved you. Now, people do that in different ways. People can express their ways in different manners. But I found out real quick, when Sharon started to come into church with some of you guys a few years ago, before she got sick, Sharon was a hugger. And she liked to hug you. And she would climb over a pew to get to you. And Sharon was not the tallest person in the world. And I'm 6'6". But she'd climb up my leg every time to get a hold of my neck. I never will forget that. I know some of you are probably embarrassed. But one of these days, I guarantee you, you'll look back and you'll smile when you think about that. Yesterday at church, I preached on the prodigal son, about it took a lot of time and effort for him to return back to God. Debbie told me after the sermon, she said, "Kip," she said, "that's kind of my mom's life." She said it was later on in her life when she realized where the priorities should lie. And said that once she realized that she returned back to God, and I could see her, the smile on her face as she would sit in the pews, that she had a special relationship with Jesus. And that's something that all of you can be comforted by. You know, this afternoon, I'd just like to relate one story to you as family and friends, and I think it's extremely fitting. It's a new story that comes from the New Testament. And Jesus had been teaching and preaching to the multitudes all day, and he was tired. And he told his disciples, he said, "Let's get in this boat and let's go across the lake to the other side." And it was a big lake. And the disciples and Jesus got in this boat and they started going across, and it's getting toward evening and starting to get dark, and a storm came up. And you guys living here in Oklahoma, you know how quickly a storm can come up, how quickly the wind can come up. And even these disciples, a lot of them were raised on the ocean. A lot of them were fishermen by trade. This was a very special storm. There was something different about this. And the waves were crashing in on the boat. Lightning was crashing, and the wind was blowing. And in the middle of this lake, they really thought they were going to die. They really thought they were going to drown. This boat's going to sink. And finally, one of them remembered that Jesus was there. Jesus had laid down in the back of the boat and went to sleep. And one of them went back and woke him up. And the Bible says, "Master, don't you care that we're going to perish, that we're all going to drown? Don't you care about us?" And the Bible says that Jesus stood up and that he looked at the wind and the waves. And he said three words. He said, "Peace be still." And immediately the winds died down. Immediately the thunder quit. The rain stopped. And I think the sky turned back to where you could see the stars. And the disciples were amazed that a man could say three words and change Mother Nature. "Peace be still." I challenge each of you today, as you are facing a difficult situation, you're facing a tremendous loss, there's going to be an empty table, an empty plate at the table. There's going to be an empty place with the holidays coming up before long. There's a tremendous hurt and loss. We have two choices. We can go through this life sad and angry, or we can do like the disciples did and turn to Jesus and say, "Can you help us?" 2,000 years later, Jesus can still speak those same words. to our hearts today. The storms are raging, the wind's blowing, but Jesus can still speak peace to your life today. And I challenge you, each one, don't get bitter, don't get angry. Turn to the one that can still speak peace to your life and say, Jesus, I need your help. I need your help to get through this. Speak those words to my life. And I believe with all my heart that he still does that today. I challenge all of you to think about that very thing.